Since 2019, Lebanon has been afflicted by an economic crisis the World Bank says ranks among the worst since the mid-19th century. Successive governments have accumulated a whole lot of debt with little to show for their spending binges, resulting in Lebanon's economic crisis. According to some economists, Lebanon's financial system turned into a Ponzi scheme, in which new money is borrowed to repay existing creditors. In the aftermath of the civil war, Lebanon balanced its books with tourism, foreign aid, earnings from its financial sector. Gulf Arab states, like Qatar and Saudi Arabia, also pumped a significant amount of money into the country by funding projects and investing in businesses. They mostly bankrolled the Lebanese state by bolstering central bank reserves. Lebanon is also the 22nd largest recipient of remittances in the world and the 16th largest among developing economies. Remittance inflows to Lebanon account for 1% of global remittances flows in 2020 and account for 12.6% of remittance inflows to Arab countries. The remittances to Lebanon began to slow down thanks to Hezbollah, a fascist Lebanese Shiite transnational organized crime group with political influence and Iranian backing. Hezbollah has sparked sectarian destabilization of communities nationwide. A litany of sectarian spats led to a deterioration of political conditions. Hezbollah also helped increase the influence of Iran in Lebanon, which has led to several Sunni Muslim Gulf states reducing their investments in the country. As a result of lower remittances and reduced foreign funding, the budget deficit grew and the balance of payments deteriorated as transfers failed to match imports of everything from basic foods to luxury items. Thanks to the sectarian spats, growing divisions, and political rivalries, Lebanon was left without a president for most of 2016. The central bank, Banque du Liban, led by former Raed Salem since 1993, introduced financial engineering, a strategy aimed at luring banks into accepting new dollar deposits with lavish returns. Commercial banks would be offered generous interest rates as high as 11% for swap operations involving government debt and US dollars. The financial engineering swaps offered bonuses and other incentives on top of enticing interest rates to commercial banks. The improved dollar flows showed up in climbing foreign reserves but also dangerously increased liabilities. The central bank's assets are now more than wiped out by what it owes. Meanwhile, the cost of servicing Lebanon's debt surged to about a third or more of budget spending. Before the 2018 election, politicians splurged on a public sector pay rise when the state needed to reduce spending. The government's failure to deliver reforms also discouraged foreign donors who held back billions of dollars in aid they had pledged. The final spark for unrest and economic collapse came in October 2019 with a government plan to tax WhatsApp calls. The planned tax would have mainly hit already struggling Lebanese who used WhatsApp to keep in touch with each other and their relatives in diaspora, who act as a financial lifeline. Youth-led protests erupted against an aging political elite, many of whom were warlords who thrived while others struggled. The inflow of foreign exchange dried up and dollars exited Lebanon. Banks could no longer pay depositors queuing outside and shut down. The currency collapsed, sliding from 1,500 liras to the dollar to a street rate of as much as 8,000 liras. Then the COVID-19 pandemic reduced the global economy and on August 4, 2020, catastrophe struck Beirut port, killing 200 and caused billions of dollars of irreparable damage, ultimately collapsing the government. Most people have reverted back to a barter economic system, trading clothes and goods for basic necessities such as food. The country is now suffering from unprecedented poverty and shortages of medicine, food, and fuel.